100 years ago this May, there was a fateful encounter in the Irish Sea. Jeffrey Brown has that story from our latest addition to the NewsHour bookshelf.
It was one of the worst maritime disasters in history, the sinking of the British passenger ship Lusitania by a German submarine on May 7, 1915. Nearly 1,200 people, including 123 Americans, were killed. It's a story of legendary proportions, but also one with a number of mysteries at its core. And it's told in the new book, Dead Wake, author Erik Larson, whose previous bestsellers include The Devil in the White City, joins me now, and welcome to you.
Thank you very much.
Unlike some of these other of your other past works, this one, more well-known, more well-trod, why did you want to come into it?
You know, at first I was a little put off by the fact that it was so well-known and so well-trod, but what I realized as I started doing some exploratory research was that there was an opportunity here, I felt, to bring something to the party that hadn't necessarily been brought before. I saw it as, because there's so much fantastic archival material, that it seemed to offer an opportunity for me to put on my Alfred Hitchcock hat and really make it a kind of an exercise in nonfiction suspense.
Suspense and mystery. So that kind of detail, and that's what you really go through here, the detail you're talking about, individual lives, diaries, letters.
Intercepted telegrams, love letters from President Wilson to his girlfriend. I mean, there was so much material. It was a surplus of riches.
This is the kind of stuff that turns you on to
this
to,
is the kind
to tell
of stuff
a story?
That turns me on. Yes, yes. I mean, anything that allows a story to advance at a fast clip, and there was so much great stuff. Yeah.
The ship, a wonder of its time, right?
Right.
A marvel.
Yes.
Also its nemesis, the submarine, a marvel in another way of its
right,
time.
Right.
So partly what grabbed me is it's a story of technology in a way.
In part it is. I mean, one of the things I had to really discipline myself to do is to go back, well, not go back in time obviously, but to adopt the point of view of the era to appreciate how new the submarine was as a weapon. Today it's very familiar to us from mm-hmm. all the run silent, run deep, and all the sonar pinging and so forth. But at this time, and by the way, there was no sonar involving submarines in World War
I. Right. It was out there blindly.
It was out there blindly, yeah. You know, essentially stumbling around, relying on charts an awful lot. But the thing that I really had to discipline myself to appreciate at all turns was how new the submarine was as a weapon of war, and how poorly understood it was, not just by civilians, but by the people who commanded the submarines, by the British Navy, by the German Navy. Nobody really understood what a submarine was capable of.
Well, so then you the other side is the people, right? So
right.
There's the large figures you mentioned, Woodrow Wilson, Winston Churchill as
right.
the first
Lord
of
the
Admiralty,
yes.
Right? But then the many, many characters, smaller
right.
figures.
Right.
Just as an example, one that grabbed me is Charles Laurier,
yeah.
Boston bookseller, right?
Right?
Why him as a way in to tell your story?
You know, I wanted to have passengers we could sort of hold hands with through the entire voyage. And Charles Laurier left one of the most detailed accounts of any of the passengers. When I say one of the accounts, I mean he left multiple traces of his story in the historic record, from testimony, a book he wrote, an amazing filing with the Mixed Claims Commission after the war. So there was a lot of rich detail. But also what I really liked about Charles Laurier was just the fact that in that era, that was considered to be the golden age of books and of book collecting and so forth, that a book collector, Charles Laurier, could be famous, mm-hmm. recognized on the street.
Imagine
could
that.
Travel, I know, and could travel first class on the classiest ocean liner mm-hmm. you know, on the sea for his annual buying trip to London.
You know, I mentioned mysteries. One of the great mysteries, of course, is, and as you document, the British well knew that submarines were in the area. They were tracking this.
Not only did they know that submarines were there, they knew that this submarine, U-20, yeah. was very likely to be in that area because they knew exactly where it was headed.
But they didn't send out naval patrol to guard the Lusitania.
Well, nor did they tell Captain Turner, who was the captain of the Lusitania, nor did they tell him that any of this was known. I mean, they knew precisely the patrol zone that this submarine was going to be in off Liverpool, which is where all the Cunard ships were headed. They also knew that nightly, the big German broadcasting center at Norddeich was broadcasting the Lusitania's comings and goings.
Why didn't they tell them? Why didn't they do more? was there, in fact, some sense for the British wanting a ship to go down to lure the Americans into the war?
It is a complicated story. Let me hang it on one historian who early on, when he wrote a book about the spy agency, the super secret spy entity in this book called Room 40, he concluded that the reason Lusitania was allowed to sail into the Irish Sea unprotected was because of, it was just a, as he put it, it was a monumental cock-up. It was a mistake. Mm-hmm. Later in life, as other evidence came forward, he changed his mind, which I found fascinating. And there is this interview at the on file in the Imperial War Museum in London, where he says that, you know, as much as he loves the Royal Navy, and he calls himself a lover of the Royal Navy, he had come to the conclusion at that point in his life that there was some kind of a conspiracy. There was something, but he couldn't, he just didn't know what kind.
All right, the book is Deadwake. Erik Larson, thanks so much.
Thank you.